just like the nation of Israel. And it's funny because now for like the last 3 weeks, we've been talking about the nation of Israel since they got out of Exodus. And it's like every single week, well, what are they going to complain about now? Right? And I'm telling you that we're not far off of that. And Satan is just, if I can get them to be discontent about something, right? I'll have them exactly where I want them. But the thing is even though he did not complain, even though he was still content, he decided it was worth it to go to the cross. And at the over cross, everything, when it came to the cross, everything changed, right? And we are living in a time where everyone is complaining. When you look around, you cannot find, you can't turn on the news without somebody complaining. You can't talk to a friend without somebody complaining. You can't even make a phone call without somebody. You know, it is just like, that's how bad it is, right? Like I guarantee you, I don't know what you guys do for work, but for work, all I hear is people complaining. And it gets really, really old. So when you think about bitterness, how easy is it for bitterness to creep into our hearts? It's everywhere around us, right? And what could it be against? You know, we could be bitter against a spouse. We could be bitter against a parent. We can be bitter against a friend. We could be bitter against a coworker. Like, there's no shortage of bitterness, right? Because there's also no shortage of hurt. But the beautiful part of this Exodus 15 story, right, is they have this bitter water. Like, there was genuine need there. Like, they were thirsty. You can't be upset at them for being thirsty. What you want to be upset at them about is the fact that, like, God just did multiple, like, you got 10 plagues, you got the parting of the Red Sea, you've got, like, all of this other crazy stuff, but then you're questioning God, right? Well, the problem is you know what they didn't have? Is they didn't have the cross. Because when Moses pointed out that piece of wood, he took the wood, he threw it in the water, and it says it made everything that was extremely bitter sweet. And if you think about what that means, if we can apply that to our life, that the cross will make the things that are bitter in our life sweet. It doesn't make sense at all. We don't understand how it happens. But when we die to ourselves and we understand the sacrifice that took place on that cross, well, first of all, once we understand the sacrifice that took place on that cross, only then, when we wrap our mind around it, only then can we die to ourselves. So only way it's going to happen, and you cannot get that order wrong, right? And we do it in a response to what he did to us. And then once we die to ourselves and we realize our current state, then our perspective changes. Everything changes, right? Because Christ put up with much more. Christ forgave much more, you know? And Christ is telling you that, yes, our situation's hard, 100%. Yes, are there situations where we get shortchanged? You know, people mistreat us, people do all of these things? Yes, very much so. But if I dealt with it, I will give you the grace to deal with it too. And the bitter can become sweet. The last story, and I think I'm 1 minute over, so I'll try to push right through this, right? And the last story is 2 Kings 6, where Elijah went and his disciples said that we need to build like a bigger place. Like, the ministry's growing, we need to do this, we need to do that. And one of them was cutting down a tree and the iron axe fell into the water. And he comes and he cries out to Elisha and he says, dude, I lost my axe head, right? And the bigger problem is that axe head wasn't mine. It didn't belong to me, it was borrowed. So Elijah asks him, says, dude, where did it fall? And show me that place. And Elijah cut off a stick, right? So sticks made out of? Wood. Okay. Cut off the stick and he threw it. And that iron axe head floated to the top. And he told the disciple, pick it up for yourself. So he reached out his hand and he took it. So like we said, that stick is the cross. And one of the things that, like, does this story make any sense at all? Have you guys ever seen like an axe head, like an iron axe head, float to the top? It makes absolutely no sense, but that is a reminder to us that anything is possible with the cross. No matter what anybody tells you, no matter what people tell you is not possible, when it comes to the cross is a game changer. It can change anything. Things that never should have happened could happen, right? The dead resurrect, the lost are found, everything, right? Times where people say that, hey, you can't do this, and then they do it. Other times where they say, I can't get it, and then they get it, right? God cares about the little things, and he's concerned with you. And the thing about this axe head floating to the top, right? The cross supernaturally gathers that which is lost. Makes absolutely no sense, right? Makes absolutely no sense. It finds things that are lost. And my question for us today is, what have we lost? Like, I guarantee you, every single one of us has lost something. It could have been, you know, our own fault. It could have been somebody else's fault. It could have been something that was taken from us. It could have been from sin. I know, especially from sin, we lose a lot, you know. And a lot of us, when it comes to the stuff that's lost, we might have even lost hope that it could ever be restored, right? You live one day at a time, but honestly, like, you're kind of over it. But the thing is like, what if God wants to restore that? What if God wants to give that back, right? It could be relationships. There's no shortage of what it could be. But the thing I want us to think about specifically in this story is, why was a worker so upset? Like, we've all lost things, but there was something special about this guy who lost something, right? And it was the fact that it was borrowed, right? And I honestly think if it was something that he owned, he probably wouldn't have cared as much, right? Because he would have lost it and he'd be like, okay, well, that's on me. Whatever, I lost it, that's my loss. But the fact that it was borrowed, you know, that made it 1,000 times worse. And my question to that is, how are you living your life? Do we live our lives like they are our own? Or do we live our lives like they are borrowed? Because the reality is, they were bought at a price. Every single one of us. Like, our life was bought at a price, right? There's this beautiful story. Abraham Lincoln was walking through the market and he was passing by a slave auction, right? And they were auctioning a young lady. And when he saw this, he bought her, right? Because, you know, we all know that Abraham, he had a very soft spot in his heart for, like, slavery. So he bought the young lady, right? And then when she came to him, he says, hey, you know, I paid your price. Here's your thing. You are free. And she said, I choose to go with you. Like, I want to stay with you. That's a symbol of the cross, guys. Right? If we understand what happened, then that just kind of changes everything. Right? And I will tell you that, you know, sometimes we're not paying attention. Sometimes we find ourselves places we're not supposed to be. We make decisions that we know are bad. And that could have been very much this guy chopping down the tree, being not paying very close attention to his axe, the condition of his axe, the maintenance of his axe, whatever it may be, right? But the only thing we know is that he lost his axe head, right? And the man of God, Elisha, threw in the stick and it came back. And I love the fact that he looked at that man and he told him, reach out your hand and take it. Reach out your hand, pick it up. And the man did it. And this is what I love, because he needed to do his part. Right? Like, Elisha did his part. He threw the stick in and the axe head came up. But the worker, the disciple, he needed to do his part too. Right? And that's exactly a picture of the cross as well, because Christ did what he needed to do on that cross. Right? He died. He overcame death. And now he's given us the authority to trample over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. He's given all of that to us, and he's telling us, do it. Pick up the axe head. Like, you have the power now. Go take it. It is in front of you. Right? So the question is what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? Why are we not living with this power? Right? We are already victorious. After what Christ did on the cross, death has no sting. Satan has no power over us, right? But I feel like the problem is that we tend to choose sin because we think it's better, but it's never better. Like, a lot of times we're not even in the fight to overcome that sin. We've accepted it because somehow we think it's better. So the question is like, are you willing to pick it up? Like, in this story, it was an axe head, and you and I's story, it's the cross. Are we willing to pick up our cross, right? And I am way over now at this point. I just want to leave you guys with this. If you want it, the power of the resurrection that overcame death, that took away the sting of death, are you willing to empty yourself out, to pick up your cross and to carry it? You know, to throw up your arms and basically say, look, my way doesn't work. I've tried that. Right? Because we all have areas in our life where even if we've surrendered 90% of them, right, there's that 10% that we're holding on to, and that's the exact 10% that might be holding you back, right? To say that I'm done with it. Like, I need the cross. I want to die to my ways, my deaths, my habits. Like, I want the power. And at that point, we just say, Lord, just show me how. Show me how. Show me my cross. Show me how to pick it up. Show me how to embrace it. Show me, guide me, and I promise you, and there's certain things in the Bible that when we pray, we know that they are in line with God. And this is one of them. And if you ask him for guidance in these areas of your life of how to pick up your cross, I believe wholeheartedly that he will show it to you. Amen? Amen. Let's stand up. Sorry, guys. I ran 7 minutes long. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, in the name of one God, amen. Dear Lord, we thank you. Because, Lord, you did the heavy lifting here. Lord, you've never asked us to do anything that you yourself had not paved the way for and shown us how to do. In the same way that you embraced your cross, Lord, that you walked towards the cross, you chose to carry your cross, Lord, and that you just emptied yourself out for us, Lord, I ask that you teach us to do the same. Lord, that you just open our eyes to our cross, Lord. Actually, Lord, I feel a lot of us, we know what it is, but we're in denial. So I ask that you just confirm to us what our cross is and practically how we pick it up, how we put it on our back, Lord, how we empty ourselves out and carry it, Lord. Because ultimately we know that that is when you come and you live inside of us. For Lord, life is good, but it could be so much better. I ask that you have that mercy and that you have grace on this group, Lord. I ask that you give us a double portion, Lord, of your spirit, Lord, that we can just be full of you. And that we hear your voice, Lord, that we see you moving. Lord, that you encourage us to spend time with you in your word daily. That ultimately we can just close the gap between us, Lord. Because we know that you are willing. I ask that you have mercy on this group, Lord, that you hear these prayers lifted in the session of our saints and martyrs. Here's we pray one voice saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, for the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All right, guys.